rolling there. We're going to move around a bit today, so it's good. I can move around too, so I will come to you. No, I'm not quite as... Oh, Mike, right? Wow. Both the speakers in the general sessions were fantastic. Like, Mike is like darting all around the room and all that. It's pretty high energy. It's good. But today, you're going to be darting around the room a little bit later. Not darting, but moving. We want to make this practical. Some of the themes are really coming through beautifully in this conference, right? What would you say, just what are, you know, maybe it's the textbook answers, but just quickly, what are some themes that are most sticking with you so far? Just shout them out, right? If you could summarize in a very short way, what's sticking in your head so far from the general sessions or what?
Just trying to connect with people, how important it is to make that connection.
Good, trying to connect with people and how important it is to make that connection. Very good.
Get out of your comfort zone.
Get out of your comfort zone. Awesome.
Develop your own spirituality.
Develop your own spirituality. That font from which we have everything to give comes from the Lord working in us.
Relationship.
Relationship.
And be joyful.
What's that? Joy?
Be joyful.
Joyful. The joy of the gospel. Love it. Good. That's good. I'm sure we can do more. It's so encouraging that these are the themes that our church, I mean, all across the world, you know, that these are the themes that the Holy Spirit is bringing into greater consciousness in our ministries. It's a beautiful thing. It's a challenging time, as we know, right? But these themes that are everywhere in the Pope's writings and in calling them out of the tradition, the saints, and using practical strategies, it's a beautiful time to do this. And like I like to say, sometimes the answers or the strategies or the approaches that we most need in evangelization, they're so close, they're like, you can't even see them. They're like, you know, if you put your finger like right here, I can't even see my own finger. You know, and we sometimes think the answers are in a lot of things, and they're good things, and we need this and we need that. And that's true. There's programs, there's events, there's planning and strategies. There's a lot of stuff like that. But I think this whole conference, and in a particular way, maybe the workshops, trying to put flesh on this and get practical, it's kind of like the church is recognizing that there's some things that are this close to us that we do already and we might do more of if we drew our attention to them a little bit and saw these close, small, really important things that if we're not doing those well, then all of the other planning and strategizing and hopes and that we try might be greatly hindered from as simple as having a daily prayer time, you know, or talking about our faith experiences, talking about the Lord in conversation. And it almost seems a little silly, like, well, come on, we're professionals, or, you know, we've been, you know, it almost seems like, aren't we past this? It's a little elementary, you know. It's not very sophisticated. And lo and behold, that's kind of exactly what we need to focus on. So in my work with the evangelical Catholic, and you know, we consult and train and a lot of ministries in both parish and campus in relational ministry and evangelization through relationships and. I just, when I first started doing this, I remember how sheepish I felt. You know, who am I to go fly to Stanford, California, and meet with these Dominican priests who have 7 degrees in theology and philosophy and know everything. It's so wonderful. They're great at what they do and all that. And I show up and I'm like, all right, let's talk about sharing your faith story, you know? And it's like, what do I have to offer here? Sure, I have a degree and I have some of the, but we don't use it. I mean, that's very beautiful and good background. But in the practical, what they needed and what their students needed was just to be able to share Jesus more naturally in conversation. And to be able, and again, it's that kind of, wow, you know, again, maybe it was right here. And if we can start doing some of these fundamentals, well in our daily lives, not just in structured programmatic ways, but in very normal everyday life. And if that could be some of the training that we pass on to others, it's exciting because it's not like it's very far off. It's like tapping into something we already know, but drawing more attention to it. And so that's maybe how this workshop will feel. I want to tap into stuff you know and you've experienced, and I want to draw a little attention to that and see how it might further our efforts for everything this conference is talking about, going out, being with people, and sharing the gospel in natural, winsome ways. And if you know, so I pray that our time together is useful for you as an individual, first of all. I don't care if you know, whether you work in a parish or the diocese or not, whether you're on an official committee or council or a team, or you know, whether you're doing anything organized for ministry or apostolate or not. The baseline, we're all baptized, right? We're all baptized. And out of our baptism comes a call from the Lord to, as we're hearing over and over again this week, to radiate the good news. And as we do that, as we learn to do that more, that will infuse every aspect of our ministries and our personal lives. So, we want to reflect on stories. But before we do, let me just start with some fun exercises that may or may not have to do with our stories, but I'll tie it in later. But let's just get us talking a little bit. Let me start. So, a question I have for you, eventually to share with a neighbor, is: do you have anything that you are kind of weirdly obsessed with? Like, you love talking about it. You know, even if you're super quiet or reserved, and you don't talk much. If you're a person of few words, under the right circumstances, you know, with a certain topic, you can just, you know, go on and on. You'd have to, like, kind of watch yourself not to freak people out about it, you know, like, oh, there he goes again. You know, like, my sister is so wonderful, and she's kind of a health nut, you know. She runs marathons, and she does CrossFit, and she's super buff, and, like, just, you know, really just, and she doesn't force it on me or anyone. She's very cool about it. But, you know, if you were to get her in the right circumstances and you ask her questions and you show you're a captive audience, you know, watch out. Like, she's just a wealth of information on this and loves it, right? For me, one of mine is, anybody here ever hear of the musician Martin Sexton? I didn't think so. Okay, so, well, no one knows about this guy, but I'm telling you, he's incredible. Okay, but you have to see him live, and every couple years he comes through Iowa, because he comes through the Midwest, and we'll stop in Davenport. Haberkamp's are good friends of mine. We go see him all the time. And anyway, this guy, you can hear his records and his albums, and you can like him, but when you see him live, it's just him, and he sounds like five musicians all at once. He's slapping bass lines with his thumb, playing the rest of his guitar with the rest of his fingers, singing this crazy range. He has every style, jazz, blues, rock, pop, you know, country, folk, and the guy is just a living music essence, and it's just incredible, super fun, amazing. So, okay, you get the idea, I'll stop now. But I could go on, and I could talk about his lyrics, and I could talk about this, and you can't shut me out, because I've been to his concerts, and they did something to me, and it's just awesome. I get very excited. And it doesn't have to be something weird or obscure, maybe, but everybody's got something. Michael talked, or how many of you were at Michael and Tasha's last session, breakout session? Okay, just one. Okay, good, not too much over that. All right, then I won't reference that. But just, what do you like to talk about? If you had a willing ear, what would make you have to kind of like check yourself and try to shut up after a little while? All right, so just share with someone next to you. Just take a couple of minutes. Now you can't go off. I know I'm baiting you, but just try it. What do you like to talk about?
Yeah.
All right, just gonna give you another 30 seconds or so, because you're just kind of announcing the topic, maybe scratching the surface.
We would do the same thing.
Well, it looks good.
All right, I'm bringing it back. What, any interesting topics come up? Anyone care to just announce a topic? One time I heard chickens. Lieutenant Columbo, I heard once. Like that old TV show, someone was really into that. What are some examples? What did you hear?
Just reality TV.
What, reality TV? Cool. All right.
Wood carving.
Wood carving, cool.
How much I hate golf.
How much you hate golf? You like talking about how much you hate golf? That's hilarious. I've never heard that. That's great. That's a good one. I love it. I mean, golf I heard, but not how much I hate golf. That's funny. Well, anyway, okay. That's okay. We all have some things we love to talk about. Even the shy or the quiet or whatever stereotype you might throw out there. Everybody. Okay, let's put that little experience to the side. Here's another little exercise. Who can tell me the capital of Delaware?
Dover,
yes, good job. Who can tell me the five pillars of Islam?
Give it a shot. Fasting,
yep.
Prayer five times a day, pilgrimage to Mecca, almsgiving,
I don't remember the other one either. Sorry. Yeah, those are the four I remember. It was prayer, fasting, almsgiving, pilgrimage. I don't remember.
Maybe
it's something with the Quran. Yeah, like memorizing it or reading it or something. Okay, anyway. Okay, put that little experience to the side. We'll come back to that. Okay, last little exercise to open us up. This one, go with me in your mind. Just concoct this situation in your mind. This one's a little more serious. Okay, imagine you're at an airport, okay? And I say airport because that means you have a limited time. You have a flight that's gonna take off, right? So you have a half hour and you're sitting having a coffee and you're in the coffee shop in the airport and you run into someone who you know and they sit down and it's someone you know. It's a friend, maybe not a super close friend, but someone knows you and this is total fabricated. It might never happen this way, but just go with me. Imagine this friend said to you something like this, and maybe by this point in the conversation, after you're talking, you have like 5 minutes left, maybe 10, five minutes until you gotta get up and go to your flight, or you're gonna be late. And with 5 or 10 minutes left, your friend says, "Hey, got a question for you. I'm not a real religious person. I never grew up with a faith much, but I was driving in my car and I heard a preacher on the radio say something about that the word gospel means good news. And it got me thinking. What's the good news? What is there like a way to summarize this? You know, I know there's churches and I know there's Jesus and I know all this stuff, but you're a Catholic or you're a Christian. Is there like a punchy way, or how do you, what's the good news? Like, I'm just curious because I don't know if I've ever heard anyone call it the good news like that. And how do I understand that? Or how do you see, what's the good news if it's supposed to mean good news? And you got 5 minutes and you got to leave. Just think, don't even share yet with the partner. Just pause for a minute and kind of go into your mind and think. And maybe you want to jot some of this down if you have a notebook, but you don't have to. But you don't have to craft a full answer here. But just what are some words or phrases that would come out in a moment like that for you? Hey, what's the good news? Is there a way to summarize it? And you say, what would come out of your mind, or come to your mind and your lips at that moment? Just pause for a moment. Now, I'm not even that interested in your answers right now. I mean, I am. That'd be a really cool thing to just go around and hear everybody's answers. And I do think we should probably allow each other. Why don't you just share with someone next to you? What are some words or phrases with no judgment, no right or wrong way to do this? You're not going to fail the Catholic test. Just what are some words or phrases that came to your mind as you did this? Just share it briefly. All right, let's pull it back here. If you're like me, this is not an easy exercise. I have a degree in theology. You know, it doesn't really, I'm not pulling it off the shelf from, you know, it's just not an easy, it is, in one sense, it's easy, it's exciting. In another sense, I find something like this quite difficult. but I'm kind of fascinated in the question and in it. And here's what I want to, so I'm sure there are really good things shared. And again, we could go around or we could shout them out. But I'm not that interested right now for this workshop in how to answer that or what the right phrases might be. I'm interested in a couple things. One, this is where I want you to remember those first two exercises we did. Here, follow me here. When you thought about what you might say in that moment, did that experience of trying to live in that moment, did that feel more like exercise one when I asked you to talk about something that you really loved? Did it feel more like that? Or did it feel more like the trivia moment of trying to pull the right answer off a shelf and that's up there in your catechetical brain somewhere, you know, like, oh. If you're like me, I think I have both of those. And I'm not saying you're a bad Catholic or, you know, if you one or the other, right? But there's a part of me, you know, when you ask me about Martin Sexton, you know, I'm excited. I'm just like if you were to, if someone were just going, hey, have you ever heard of Martin Sexton? I'd be like, yeah, you know, and I'd be excited because for a little moment I have this captive audience and I can talk about this musician that has kind of done something in my soul, even on a superficial level, you know, but just kind of resonates with me. But if someone were to come up to me and ask me the three branches of government or, you know, the five pillars of Islam or even the seven, you know, corporal works of mercy, as much as they mean to me, I'd still be like, I'd go off to that, I think it's the left part of my brain, and I would just kind of go to that shelf in there, and I'd be like, okay, what was it again, you know? And it's a very different space in my soul. It's a very different space in my head when I'm pulling off a right answer from the shelf, like a textbook, and when I'm talking about something I have deeply experienced, right? And bring that up as an exercise, just because regardless of the exact, I'm sure all kinds of good, true, wonderful, theologically rich words just came off of that shelf in that little moment. And maybe there are better and worse ways to say it, sure, you know, all of that. But what I want to tap into and encourage is to see an opportunity like that, fabricated as it might be, as a moment to speak about, from your personal experience, something deeply transformative and good and beautiful in your life. So just like when I started telling you about Martin Sexton, I didn't just tell you about him, I did, about his music, but I said, I saw him live, and it did something to me. In a moment like that, might we say, well, sure, you know, we might articulate some basic truths of the faith, go to the first paragraph in the catechism, if you want a good summary, by the way, of the gospel. Katie just mentioned it in her talk earlier, right? The first words of the catechism, are the first paragraph. It's like the best kerygma, good news summary, in one paragraph, I think, that's out there. Maybe along with some of the scripture verses, you know, God so loved the world and all that. But, so there are great messages, you know, articulations of the kerygma, the good news. And we should know those. But I want to tap into that subjective kerygma, the personal experience. And in a moment like that, is there part of us that sings inside? Because I get to share now a little bit, just a tiny bit, with my friend about how I have experienced the good news. So not just, how is Jesus the good news? And yes, our answers should say the name of Jesus somewhere in there, hopefully. Because Jesus is the good news. But not just in some four spiritual laws or some abstract sense of the right answer. But how has Jesus been good news to us? That's what people are longing to hear. Even if, like Katie said, you don't see the fruits of that right away. Even if they don't say, oh my goodness, how could I not too prevent me from, you know, baptize me right now. What then shall I do? Some of those conversions and acts, you know, not always going to happen that way. But we got to speak about our best friend. We get to speak about the one who loves us. And in a way that is personal. In a way that is real. In a way that is shows the impact of the good news. Capital G, capital N, with a face and a name and eyeballs. The good news that is Jesus Christ and how what he has meant for us. So that little moment might never happen exactly that way, where someone says, excuse me, could you please summarize the good news for me? And might. We should be prepared for that. That'd be great. But maybe it happens in a thousand other ways without that direct, those words, right? How about when, and this is where it just comes out of, you know, life. A friend of mine, I had gotten to know this guy, kind of doing what Katie was talking about. You know, we met some people at Mass, invited them over for dinner. My wife and I trying really hard to cultivate some community and relationships. Nothing, no agenda, no plans, no programs, no small groups yet. We got there eventually, but just building relationships and so a guy who became a good friend, kind of as we're getting to know each other, he said, I knew he was interested in spiritual things, right? I mean, he was Catholic, but you know, that doesn't say a whole lot necessarily in terms of how open someone is, right? And I know he was interested and open and starting to trust me. And I knew he wanted to grow spiritually, but he wasn't that comfortable talking about everything. And anyway, one time this funny little incident happened where I was, I wasn't with my friend, I told him about it later, but I was in my morning prayer chair. You know, every morning I like to get up early, have coffee, open my Bible, have my prayer time, and it's real, you know, it's like my peaceful beginning of the day with Jesus. And a bird fell down my chimney and flew out of the chimney right next to me and was flapping all over the room. And did you ever see the movie The Great Outdoors with John Candy and the bat flying around? It's just this crazy scene trying to catch this bat. And It wasn't that dramatic, but it kind of reminded me of that. So just the contrast of like the stillness and the quiet and the prayer, and then this me trying to catch this bird and get it out of my house. And anyway, I told him that story, but I you know, without being showy, without being flashy, without trying to be holier than thou or anything, I mentioned as part of the contrast to that, but as a, you know, just, you know, we hadn't really talked about prayer or spiritual things yet, but I just mentioned that, you know, it's so funny because this bird flew into my house and I was just trying to have this quiet time, you know. I like to start out my day with the Bible and with coffee and just kind of shared that. But I was very intentional about including the small detail that I start out every day with the Bible and prayer, right? Again, not to be showy, just because I wanted to include that detail. And a couple weeks later, he had asked me, he goes, "Hey, you said you started those days with your Bible. What do you do there? I'm kind of interested in something like that. Can you tell me more about that?" And it was so cool because that opened up a much deeper level of our relationship. And he was hungry and open, and I was able to then, you know, prompt a deeper conversation. "Well, tell me about what prayer is for you." And we talked about it, and he started praying, and I gave him some resources. He started reading his Bible. This opened up like this deeper spiritual friendship, which then became kind of like a mentoring relationship without ever really even trying, but because a little story I was able to share. And then when he did ask me more about it, I didn't start preaching to him. I didn't just start teaching. The teaching came when he was hungry and would ask me questions. But when he first asked me more about that, "Hey, tell me about that. What did I do?" I didn't give him a catechesis on the Bible or on prayer, or I didn't, you know, I gave him a little testimony about how I experienced the Lord and what prayer does for me and how the Lord has met me there. And so that's a little example of just a testimony moment, a faith story that I sort of, there's lots of these examples. That's one that I often think of it was probably because of trainings like this and having this thing that is so close to us and reflecting on it a little more. I was very intentional about sharing some of those details in that story and then taking, you know, the opportunity that was opened up and sharing more. And so that's the kind of image, that's the example of our stories aren't 10-minute, 1-hour, you know, whatever, long stories about our whole life. We can talk an hour or 3 or 10 or 20 about our lives. We have many stories to tell. But can we weave into our lives tiny little 10-second testimonies? And then see who's interested and open, right? And by the way, this is only half of it. The other half, which is really being emphasized here even more, and I'm emphasizing in my afternoon workshop, which is actually primary, which is earlier than sharing your story, which is getting to know the stories of others. And that's what Katie talks so beautifully. Listening, walking in the wrong direction for a while, not meaning into sin, but accompanying people wherever they are, listening, asking questions. So I'm presuming, and then with my buddy, there was a lot of asking questions and walking with before I shared a little more and then I was able to share more and do some teaching and helping because I had gained trust. And now he saw me as someone who wasn't just out with an agenda, but truly cared for him. And so this all presumes that, and we just have an hour, so we're focusing on the part where when we get to speak, you know, when someone says, or in subtly or directly, "Hey, how did you get through that? How did you decide where to send your kids to high school?" You know, and you know, and you're like, "I don't even know if I made the right decision, but here's you know how I wrestle with that now in prayer, and what the Lord has brought me to." Right. So whatever the question is in life, as you share life with friends, these things come out, and if we can seed them with tiny, tiny little tastes of experiences of change and of goodness and of beauty, that we've experienced the good news of Jesus, and people want more, and we have more of an opportunity to share that subjective kerygma, the good news that Jesus is to us. So that's where I want to go. And you know, this, I just want to emphasize that the testimony, the faith story, whether it's long or big or small, this is one of our greatest tools for using words in evangelization. We know, you know, the thing, like, preach the gospel always, when necessary, use words, you know. So we got to live it. We preach with our lives. We preach with our integrity. We serve. We love. But when we use words, the very first thing, the best tool we have is often our testimony. We can teach and we can be objective as people need that. Katie talked about that as well. People want answers. But they often want answers once they know you're a witness and that you've shared something real about yourself. So we want to practice that a little bit. Just a little bit on that, about our testimonies. You know the passage, a great scripture to go with this, of course, 1 Peter 3:5 and 6. So just if you want a verse to tie this to, I know many of you probably have it memorized or know this one pretty well, but it's so perfect. 1 Peter, why am I not seeing it? Did I get it wrong? 1 Peter 5, whatever. Always be ready, it's somewhere, maybe it's 15, 1 Peter 3:15-16. Yeah, there it is. I just took the one off. Always be ready to give a reason to anyone who asks of you about your hope. Anyone who demands an account of the hope that is within you. Always be ready to give a reason. Yet do it with gentleness and reverence. Just love that. You know, so that's what we want to practice a little bit today. You have a story. You have a story of faith. You have conversion. The word conversion, such a beautiful and rich tradition, that we're called to ongoing conversion, right? Catechism says in paragraph 1431, conversion is a radical reorientation of our whole life, a return, conversion to God with all our heart. Now, as you know, conversion is both a sacramental journey and a lifelong discipleship journey. We're always in the process of converting. We should all have orange construction cones on our heads right now. We are works in progress. Our stories are not done yet. We're not finished. So right away, when we talk about conversion and stories, there might be some of you, kind of like I feel sometimes, which is you know what? I don't like the pressure of having to feel like, oh, look at me, I'm this arrived product, be like me, you know, all that stuff. No, we're not making ourselves out to be perfect, but we're also not denying the good work that the Lord has done in us. And other people need to hear about that. It's not being arrogant and showy to testify, to magnify the Lord, because he has done great things for us. That's what we want to tap into. Conversion stories, little or big, are non-confrontational. They're winsome. In a modern world, people like to hear, does it work? They want to know if it works, even if they don't show it. They like infomercials. We all hate infomercials, but at the same time, we can't stop watching them because it's so compelling to see the before and the after. It's like, oh my gosh, looks like it really works. But then you're like, this is a scheme. It's not true. So that's like not a real authentic example, but the before and the after, we do want that. We do want to see that something works. Does the good news work? Or is it just some ancient stuff on a page? People can't argue with your experience. So when we think about conversion, you might have different types of conversion, right? So again, we talked about we're all in the process of more conversion. But you might have a stronger moment in your life when you really encountered the Lord. And maybe powerful moments that changed you. That there's a before and there's an after. You know, there's a way that you were, and then the Lord broke into your life in some new way. And then after that, you were different. Again, not done, not perfect, but different, changed. Happier, holier, better, freer. That's the kind of stuff. Maybe it's a moment. Maybe, you know, you don't have these big moments, and you always wondered, well, I don't have that, you know. But maybe then you look at a season You know, St. Paul had the great moment, right? St. Paul on the road to Damascus, or Damascus, yeah. And he's, you know, like, you know, whoa, Jesus appears to him. Maybe it's a season of great struggle. Look at, you know, St. Augustine, wrestling for so many years, sinning with gusto, but, you know, wrestling, and eventually, you know, kind of surrenders in a graced moment. Even there, there's a moment of conversion, but maybe other examples of, it's not quite so clear when it all clicked, but you know what? You look back and you see, 10 years before that thing, I was this way, and now I'm free of that, or I'm experiencing a great measure of freedom that I didn't previously. So it might be a season in your life. It could be a life that's just always, and this is kind of what we hope for some, you know, maybe it's been a life always close to the Lord, you know? But even in a, like St. Therese, you know, of Lisieux, like, just always close. But even there, she'll be the first to tell you there's all kinds of deeper conversions going on. It's just at a more subtle level. It's at a more interior level. There's always growth. The Lord is an infinite ocean, and we're always learning and growing. So as we reflect on our stories, ask the Lord to help you find some way, some before and after, that you could share about. And that's what we want to do today. If this is new, if it's, you know, maybe this is old hat for you. By the way, if this is super, I mean, you came for a reason, so you obviously want to. But if this is like super easy and all that, and you know all this, watch the rest of this workshop as, from the lens of something you could lead others in. Because people love to learn about this, and they learn, they have this tool, and they don't need a theology degree. And it's really fun to train people and form people in evangelization through this lens of story, because starting today, we can all just embrace it and kind of see the world through the lens. So reproduce a workshop like this. Make it your own, you know? It could be something you do with the team. But anyway, so just, you know, feel free to run. All right. So we're going to take a little time for reflection. And actually, if you could pass out the sheets now, great. Just a little handout here that can guide you. Should have just about enough. I think we have enough. And if you don't, well, I'll deal with that if we don't. It's not a big deal. It's not rocket science. I'm going to take about 10 minutes to just reflect and to write a little bit. Maybe eight minutes. Okay? Write a bit. Pray. I'm going to lead us off in a prayer in a second. But to just highlight an experience of before, and then during, and then after. And as you do, and then put some thoughts down, and then we're going to share with each other, okay? So be aware that it's something that you are willing to share. Not with the whole group up in a microphone, but just with a partner, okay? And it's going to be fun. I'm going to be like a drill sergeant, you know, I'm going to time you. You're going to share a 3-minute version of your story. And I'm going to time you and cut you off, okay? But we're going to start easy, because 3 minutes is kind of long, believe it or not. But you can't summarize your whole life in 3 minutes. But you can do a before, and then an encounter, and then an after, okay? Couple tips before I set you loose on this. Try to use the name of Jesus. It could be a little hard. At least use the name of God. Like, mention God. Don't just talk about, it might sound silly, but it's really easy to talk about the faith, the church, my faith, my spirituality. You see what those things don't? Those things don't have eyes and flesh. Those things didn't take on flesh and had hands and fingers and a soul. Right? The faith is a wonderful tradition. But talk about the Lord. And if you can, use the name of Jesus, because there's power in the name of Jesus. Catechism says when the name of Jesus is said, something happens. It's the only name that affects what it signifies, whatever that means. It means that the Lord God gave us his name, Yahweh, yes, but then even more, Jesus. The Lord is here, present. Speaking his name is powerful. You don't have to preach it. No preachimonies, okay? Don't preach. Just share. But use the name of the Lord. Don't speak religionese. Don't use a lot of catechetical language. And try to avoid unnecessary details because you only have a little bit of time, right? So what's the theme of the before and the after? And how did the encounter, a moment, a season, whatever it is, how did the encounter with the Lord bring you from the before to the after? Okay? But just don't go down the rabbit holes of all the details and your Aunt Sally and this and whatever. I mean, you can mention Aunt Sally, but be brief on those details and stick with that theme and try to go to that before, during, and after. This is kind of fun. This is very clinical. Again, we're kind of forcing this clinical exercise so that we can do this more and more naturally in our daily lives. But we'll have fun with it because we're all in the same room knowing that this is an awkward clinical exercise. Okay? All right, any questions? Okay, we'll have fun with this. Trust me, everybody has fun with this. Oh, and don't exaggerate either. That's the last tip. Don't exaggerate. You don't have to be showy or flashy. You don't have to have this amazing, oh my goodness, you know, you need to share this and write a book about it. It might just be a very simple thing that someone needs to hear because they're experiencing God in very simple ways and they need to know that the Lord is in that. All right? So, take a few moments and reflect through that. Does everybody have one? We had enough, right? Perfect. Okay, I'll play a little music into the microphone here and just take a few moments with that worksheet. If you don't get all the way through it, that's okay, but just keep in mind, it's just trying to pull out a before, an encounter, and an after. And finally, just to kick you off on that, Holy Spirit, come. Even as we do this sort of exercise, Lord, this quote-unquote training, and Lord, protect us from a mechanical sort of wrong spirit about this. Lord, we're speaking of you, our friend and our Savior, the one who has reached into our lives. I just pray for the grace to see one small way right now that you're calling each of us to reflect on. Maybe we can take it further in prayer this week, but just now, Lord, we ask for the grace to help us to see and to articulate one way that you have been good news to us. Praise you, Lord.
Thank you.
two more minutes. I know it's kind of short, but your stories are close to your heart, so. Up for now as you're able, even if it's incomplete on your sheet, it's complete in your mind and your heart. And I don't want you to feel like there's really a wrong way to do this. For as much as I give you the tips, those are just some things to think about. But this is beyond technique, this is beyond, you know, this isn't this is real life. This is us. And praise the Lord for Him chasing us and breaking into our lives and continuing to encounter us as He continues the work that He started in us, as St. Paul says. So let's share a little bit of the ways that we have experienced the good news of Jesus Christ. Okay, so here's what we're going to do. Here's where y'all need to get a little nervous. Now it's beautiful. So we're gonna stand up, just kind of mix around and find a partner, okay? Let's just do that much right now, okay? So you don't have to bring your sheets. That was just to get your mind. You wanna do this from, that was just priming the pump. You can leave your worksheets where they are. We don't want any scripts, no reading, okay? So stand up and find a partner. It's gotta be one-to-one, no threes, and no one out unless, you know, you just really want, you know, if I'm like killing you right now, but you can do it. We'll let you find someone. It's always, you know, the tough part. Anybody need a partner yet? Are you kind of documenting things? Are you the? Sure. That's good. I can fill in. I can be the extra if. So raise your hand if you don't have a partner yet. Okay, then I will be with you, sir. Okay, I'll be a little distracted because I have to watch the time. So, here's what we're going to do, everyone. Decide who's going to go first, okay? And then, I'm going to give you 3 minutes to share. And then I'm just going to, I'll try to give you a little warning about when we're almost done. And then I'll say stop. And then, sorry, we're just going to swap and the other person's going to go. So, try to wrap it up. That's why I'll give you that warning. But this is long enough to share a little bit, but most of us have trouble keeping it from going longer. So, you know, whatever. And if you finish a little early, then you can just have a little discussion. The person could ask a follow-up question, and you can practice those good listening skills. Okay? There shouldn't be any awkward silences after. You know, if they finish up early, then the person can ask questions. Okay? All right. So, let me pull up my timer. 3 minutes. And go. All
right. It strikes on a particular day, November 25th, 1971, was Thanksgiving Day. I was stationed in the Army and working in the military for 3 years. I toured duty in Korea. looking forward to getting out in a few months.
My daughter just experienced that.
There are 1 minute to go, 1 minute. Okay, that's time. I'm nice, I'll give you 10, 15 seconds to wrap up again and say your nice comments. Okay, so we're going to switch. All right, ready? If you haven't started yet on the other one, I didn't really tell you, but it's fine. Just whatever you did is fine. But if you haven't started yet, okay, ready? Other person, go. Start.
Thank you.
believe the.
Okay, 1 minute on this one, 1 minute. Be nice to each other and wrap it up. We are just about at time. But I'm going to squeeze one. I have one more minute. I'm going to use it. Okay, here's what I'm going to do. What's our next thing? Is it lunch next?
Yes.
For some.
Okay, for some. Okay. All right. Real quick. Find a new partner, one person, a 1 minute story or less. I'm gonna time you. Ready? Stand up, find another partner. Half of you are off the hook. Ready? Okay, we're just there's rapid fire here. We're gonna do a 1 minute. Ready? One, two, three, go. Hi, I'm Andre.
The good news is
Okay, that was over a minute. I was too into the story. Thank you, Chair. Wow, beautiful. Okay, I know we're at our time. This is kind of, I mean, we tapped into some deep wells, right? In a way that doesn't do justice to the sacredness of our stories, but it does. And in another sense, it does, right? Like, how cool that, so we don't even know each other. And yes, it's a clinical exercise, but in literally 1 minute, you can know something of the deepest part of someone's life and see the way that God met someone and was good news. That's awesome. And as Catholics, we need to share these stories. People, the world needs to hear. And as we draw people out of their stories and their lives, we gain opportunities in 1 minute. Can be the difference that could lead into years of conversation, mentoring, sacramental life. You never know. 20 seconds could be the difference in someone's life because of a tiny little snippet of a before and after that they then followed up on, and you were able to share more. What a blessed journey. We have this tool in our pockets at all times. Yes, we need the Holy Spirit to know when. We don't just go around and, you know, this isn't a mechanical thing. It's not a project. But this is the Lord's grace in our lives, and let's not be shy about how He might want to use that in some. Everybody has some stories that someone needs to hear. So thank you for jumping in and for rushing here at the end. And now you know a little bit more about people. You know, you can follow up and have more conversations over lunch. But God bless you. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. The Father, and Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. May the Lord be on our minds, our lips, and our hearts. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.